Welcome to Worship with Messiah Online. Glad you're with us today. A couple announcements. On Saturday, September 10, from 4:30 to 7 p.m., we'll have our fall kickoff event, Back in the Saddle. We'll have a chili cook-off, pony rides, bounce house, country music. We'll welcome Pastor Bob back from his sabbatical. Mark your calendars, save the dates, sign up online so we know you're coming. Now, despite the fact that I'm here on video, I'm actually on vacation this week. I'll be back on Thursday, August 25, that is. Pastor Jerry Crawford is available for emergency pastoral care. You can call the church office and they can put you in touch with Pastor Jerry. Pastor Charles Newman is our guest preacher today. I think you'll be in for a treat. Now let's begin worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy.
Let's pray. Lord God, with your faithful followers of every age, we praise you, the rock of our life. Be the center of our lives. Form us into the body of your Son, so that we may gladly minister to all the world you love. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Now here's Pastor Charles.
I don't know about you, but I just love a good story. I love campfires. I love bedtime stories, because stories have a way of helping us to remember what has happened, to remember a story. And so today's story is one that we're pretty familiar with. It's known in the Bible as, in Matthew's gospel, as Jesus sending out of the 12. So here in Matthew's gospel, at this point in chapter 10, he's sort of identified who his disciples are, back in like chapters 4 and 5, where he's called out of the wilderness. And so now we find Jesus in chapter 10, where he's doing something a little different. You see, up until this point, the disciples were simply doing what Jesus said, come and follow me. So the disciples up until this point were just simply following Jesus. And they were amazed at the things that Jesus was doing. But now in chapter 10, we see this becomes a very pivotal moment in our story. In this moment, I want us to understand the power of an invitation and challenge. That's right. Our story today is about the power of invitation and challenge. That's exactly what Jesus did with his disciples. You see, Jesus invited them to do the very things that they had saw him do. As Jesus said, come, follow me, now it's come and you go and do it too. And we see that this is a high challenge. We see that what Jesus is asking them to do is the very thing that he himself had done. And wow, were they amazed. And so in this story, one of the first things we see is that Jesus provides to his disciples authority and power. And the authority and power that Jesus gives, well, it's given for a purpose. Jesus granted his disciples, and by in turn, it translates to us, that we are given the authority and the power for a purpose. And as Jesus tells them in Mark chapter 1, it says, Jesus called his 12 disciples to him, and he gave them authority to drive out the impure spirits and to heal every sickness, every disease and sickness. You see, that was the purpose was that Jesus would grant them this ability of supernatural healing. The disciples were now able to do the very things that they saw Jesus do. I know that is so hard for us to see and for us to really comprehend or understand, that they could drive out impure spirits. Now, we can debate, what does that mean today? How do we interpret that? Some would argue mental health issues, mental health challenges, problems, a sickness of the soul. Jesus granted them the authority and the power over diseases, the things that cause people sickness and brokenness. Jesus granted the disciples to be able to heal. Now, I know it is so easy for us, for you, right there at home or in the coffee shop, for you to go, yeah, well, that was way back then. There's no way that works today. But here's what we know. The whole point of Jesus's mission, Jesus actually called his disciples, and then later on in Matthew's gospel, in the 28th chapter, Jesus says, okay, you've been with me, you've done these things, now I want you to go and make disciples all over the nations, all over the world. And I want you to do the very things that I have taught you. That was Jesus's command. We know it as the Great Commission. But as Jesus is here and now, he gives them this authority and power. The authority and power to really deal with the spiritual hurt that people were experiencing. To deal with the physical pain that people were experiencing. So Jesus calls his 12, and this is what they're able to do. I think it's also important in this story to understand and to know the strategic plan of Jesus. Jesus didn't just say, okay, here you go. I'm giving you this authority and power. Go for it. Jesus actually had a plan. And I believe in Jesus's plan. Obviously, I believe in his plan or I wouldn't be a pastor. But I love this plan because it is still so appropriate for us today. Jesus says this in Matthew chapter 10, starting at verse 5. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. And as you go, proclaim this message. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, and drive out demons. Freely you have received, and freely you give. Now, Jesus' strategic plan was for his followers to really start first with what is called the lost sheep of Israel. You see, when Jesus first started his mission, he didn't just say, you know, open up the doors and sort of go anywhere. No, Jesus called his disciples to really focus on those people that they had most in common with. I know when we think about how can we help more people to grow in a relationship with God? One of the things that I continue to say over and over again is how we know church attendance is in a decline. But really, that's not the point. The point is, are we raising people to be followers of Jesus and lovers of God? You see, are we focused more on our institutional practices and identity, or do we want to do the things that Jesus told his disciples to do? Do we want to heal the sick? Do we want to drive out demons? Do we want to be able to raise the dead? I know that seems so far-fetched, so like mythical, but it is very practical because Jesus says, I want you to first start with the lost sheep of Israel. Don't worry about going to Gentiles or the Samaritans. Now, this was important because Gentiles, those were considered like unclean people. They weren't pure. They were really just the lower class citizens. And the Samaritans, well, they were like kind of okay, like half Jewish, half Gentile. So they were kind of okay, but not really. But Jesus says, I don't even want you to worry about them. I want you to go to the lost sheep of Israel. In other words, go to your friends, go to your family, go to those who you have most in common with. I want you to stay there. I want you to begin to heal them. This was Jesus's great strategic plan. And I think about that for us as we desire for more and more people to know about God's love. You know, just this past weekend, as we celebrated 4th of July, we learned of another mass shooting. We learned of another story of brokenness, of hurt. In fact, there were several mass shootings. And it's leaving so many just wondering why. What can we do? It's leaving all of us just saying, enough is enough. We have to turn the tide. How do we do that? Well, it is a very complex question. It is a very complex issue to solve. But I believe Jesus gives us some clues and insights. Start with those that we have a relationship with. Make sure that we are investing in the people that are right there around us. Are we taking time to check in, to say hello, to say, come, hang out with us, to be present in their everyday life? This was Jesus's strategic plan. And as the disciples continued on this pattern, I think it's so important to know that these 12 that Jesus picked, they were not perfect. These were not the ideal candidates that anyone would use to start a movement of helping people to find their way back to God. No, these were a group of ragtag, just sort of, well, scripture calls them ordinary people. But Jesus had so much faith in them. Jesus knew that the power of God was available to each and every one of them, regardless of their profession, regardless of their past. And Jesus chose to invest in them. Jesus chose to challenge them to take up this mantle, to be a part of this movement of God's reconciling love in the world. And so it is for you too. That's right. Our invitation and challenge is the same. We have the ability to have the power to influence the culture around us. That is my hope and prayer for you today and this week and the rest of our lives, that you begin to understand your capacity to and the power that you have to influence the culture around you. Jesus says this to his disciples: do not get any silver or gold or copper to take with you in your belts, no bag for the journey, or an extra shirt or sandals or a staff, for the worker is worth his keep. In whatever town or village you enter, search there for some worthy person and stay at their house until you leave. As you enter the home, give it your greeting. If the home is deserving, let your peace rest on it. If it is not, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, leave that home or town and shake the dust from your feet. What I love about this is Jesus gives us a very practical way to begin to influence our culture. Jesus tells them, basically, don't take anything for this journey. I want you to be humble. I want you to be vulnerable. I want you to live a life just as I myself do. And so as they go off on this journey, Jesus tells them as they're going to heal the sick, as they're going to cast out demons, that they're to go into the town and search for what we call a person of peace. Think about that. Who are the people of peace in your life? Who are the people that you feel just a natural chemistry, connection? And with that person, you're like, wow, you see amazing things happening in their life, or you see the potential. Jesus invites the disciples to find those people out and to stay there, to hang out, to really begin to build a sense of community and family with that person of peace. As we seek to build that culture of influence for the glory and the power of God, I believe it is so important that we understand who those people are. Who are those people of peace that just seem to have a way of connecting with other people, of gathering with other people? They're sort of a contagious person that you like to be with. People like to be around them. What would it look like if we began to invest in those people? I believe that if we began to share our life with those people who, they're just open. There's a sense of a desire for them to follow you, just like the followers of Jesus followed Jesus. if we desire to do all that we can, if we desire to turn the tide in our culture, if we desire to see not so much division and hate, if we desire to not continue to have our hearts broken, if we desire for a generation to experience hope, I believe it starts with our ability to turn and to recognize and to celebrate those people of peace. As we look at this story, it is packed with the amazing nature of God and His goodness through His Son, Jesus. We're reminded of the hope and the promise that Jesus had in His disciples, and therefore He has in us. And so I pray that as you reflect on this story, that you are encouraged, that you too are a disciple, that you too, in your ordinary, everyday life, that you can make a difference, that you are making a difference, that you, as you search for those people of peace, as you invest in those people and those places, that the authority and power that God has granted to you, that you will allow for hope to rise, for forgiveness and grace to be experienced by all. May God's love, may His strength, and may His glory be forever and ever. Amen.
Thanks, Pastor Charles. Let's continue with reciting our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Malachi chapter 3, verse 10 tells us, "Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, so that there may be food in my house. And test me now on this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you a blessing until it overflows." This passage doesn't promise that God will make us rich. I've been waiting for that, by the way. But this passage does promise that God will supply us our needs and bless us if we're willing to grow in faith and trust. Your giving to Messiah not only helps support our ministries, it helps you grow in faith as you rely more fully on God for your well-being. As always, you can support our ministry making a gift to Messiah in a variety of ways, including texting Messiah YL to the number on the screen, giving online through your online banking or our website or our app, or by writing a check. Thank you for your continued generosity and for making a difference as we seek to live out our mission of loving God and loving one another. Please join me in prayer. Almighty God, giver of all things, with gladness we give thanks for all your goodness. We bless you for the love with which you created us and which sustains us from day to day. We thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior, who gave his life for us and is truly present in us through the gift of faith. We thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit, for your church, and the opportunities you provide for us to experience your love, grace, and mercy. Help us to treasure in our hearts all that you have done for us and to give our lives to you in service. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. Now gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let's join in the prayer that our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Now let's sing our sending song.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy. Thank you.
receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord look upon you with grace and favor. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord with joy. Thanks be to God.